nature of available sources means that most of what we know about inhabitants of the Roman Empire is mostly reserved to the privileged group of society, as they were likely to leave behind long-lasting monuments. Epigraphic monuments, especially votive inscriptions, are thus the best evidence for the presence of women in public places, such as, for example, sanctuaries or temples. Therefore, they could be characterized as those inscriptions, of course, as communal or as objects for admiration or inspiration, not only for other women. Votive inscriptions are also one of the few categories of finds which allow a glimpse into the female participation in Roman religion. Besides the name of god or goddess from whom such monuments was set up, we can derive information from the text of inscription which would otherwise be completely unavailable. From a name of dedicant of women who set up such inscription, we can determine, besides, of course, gender, occasionally the social status and cultural background as well. Whether the dedicator was, for example, immigrant, citizen, or peregrine. Without stones with inscriptions, the study of religion in Roman provinces would scarcely exist. Such a blanket statement is, of course, an exaggeration. Much could still be learned from the rich material remains about sanctuaries, iconography, and even cult practices. But apart from a few scattered and incidental references in literary sources, we would know almost nothing of the names of deities worshipped, very little of religious organization and cult personnel, and far less about key issues such as the interaction of local and imperial religious traditions. If we want to know what deities were worshipped in a particular area, or what sorts of people worshipped them, or what religious institutions existed, their epigraphic evidence are our most important source. Stones are also one of the few categories of finds which allow any glimpse into participation of women in Roman religion. There aren't many evidences that women, especially those who came from Roman provinces, participated in public religious life. The majority of known literary sources were written by patrician males about patrician males and, for surprise, patrician males. What explains lack of sources concerning women? The, let's say, marginal role of women's participation in religion is strikingly connected to their position in Roman society. They were deprived of many laws who had only men. Moreover, some of the Roman authors, for example, Cato, if I remember correctly, wrote that there existed prohibitions which didn't allow women, except of priestess, drinking wine without water, or even cutting raw meat. Both of these acts were necessary in sacrificing, which was a very important aspect in Roman religion. Because of women's incapacities and exclusions, founding of inscription was one of the most important ways to express their religiosity in a public space. The study of women attracts attention more and more often, but still there's a big gap in this research, especially in Eastern European Roman provinces. The aim of this paper is an attempt to reconstruct the religious life of women who lived in Roman province Dalmatia, using votive inscription as a great example. I chose Roman Dalmatia for my research because there was found the highest number of Latin inscriptions with the name of a woman on it among all Roman provinces. In epigraphic databases, I found circa 130 inscriptions, which were set up by a woman or a woman with her, for example, husband or partner or her family. It depends. Moreover, this is the highest number and the bigger proportion between all the votive inscriptions in Roman provinces, especially southern or eastern in Europe. In Dalmatia, it's, as I said, 130 out of 900 votive inscriptions, which were set up only by men. Contrary in some other provinces, in Dacia it's 60 founded by women out of circa 1,500. In Mesia Inferior it's only 31 out of over 500. In Mesia Superior it's 20 out of almost 400. In Pannonia Inferior it's 50 out of almost 1,020. And in Pannonia Superior it's 120 out of circa 1,500. It could mean that in Dalmatia women could more actively participate in public religion, but of course the number of inscriptions is not objective. We know that, for example, in Dacia and in both Mesias there were many military camps, so probably the population of men was bigger there than, for example, in Dalmatia. Moreover, during Christian times, the pagan inscriptions were frequently used as building material, for example, for city walls, or even for churches. Or, moreover, it's possible, it's sure, that epigraphic databases online are not complete, so for being more objective, it is necessary to search all of the corpora with inscriptions and archaeological reports from the present territory of Croatia, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Montenegro, Kosovo, Serbia and Albania, so I've got a lot more to do in the future. And what is also interesting, Dalmatia is one of the most diversified ethnically Roman province, even after Roman conquest. The picture which has emerged from the detailed studies of Slantyportal scholar like Geza Alfeldi suggests the following distinct ethnic and geographical groupings: the Apodes, the Liburni and the Dermate, the Pannonias in northern Dalmatia, the people of eastern Dalmatia, and some Celtic people also in north. And all of these, let's say tribes, because tribe is not the proper word, but I can't find the better one, had their religious system, which means that if some of, for example, Ligurian women worship Roman deities by setting up for them inscription, that means she expressed in some way her adherence to the Roman world and to the Roman culture. Most of our data about divine names comes from dedicatory inscriptions, which are by far the most common type of inscription that concerns religious life in the provinces. As already suggested, these inscriptions provide valuable information not only about gods, but also about their worshippers. Inscriptions, even those of poor quality, cost money and were consequently beyond the means of most people. Moreover, the practice of inscribing dedications on stone was to a large extent an extremely Roman one. Most provincials who erected dedicatory inscriptions were thus adopting Greco-Roman cultic practice, whether consciously or not. We must accordingly be aware that, for both reasons, the data provided by dedicatory inscriptions concern a particular segment of the population. Nevertheless, the information that we can derive from them is a sort of that would otherwise be completely unavailable. From a name, we can normally determine gender, dedicator, and occasionally something more than that. Among all of women, there were, for example, freed women who were identified by liberation, so it's here, by naming their patronus or owner who manumitted them. This is sometimes called pseudo filiation or false filiation. For example, here we deal with Darmoka Secunda from Birimir, who was liberated by Celma. Unfortunately, we don't know for who she set up this altar. And in the second example, we deal with Trozia Prima from Benkovac, who set up this altar, votum solvit libens merito, what means willingly and deservedly fulfilling her sacred pledge. And both of these inscriptions are dated to 1st and 2nd century AD. Contrary to freed women, there is a quite numerous group of women who set up inscriptions only by their own. We can suppose that they had enough money for it, and probably it was their money, not his father or husband, as the Roman law said. So they had probably a higher social status, so they were widow. In Dalmatia, there is much more inscriptions set up only by women than in the other European provinces. And in my future research, I would like to create a map of all votive inscriptions from Dalmatia to analyze if there are some connections between dedicants and their social status and the ethnic group which they belong to. In first example, visible on presentation, we deal with Junia Varenna, who founded the altar for Juno in modern Nin. In the second case, the inscription was founded by Cornelia Tertia for Jupiter Optimus Maximus, and we know that she was daughter of Caius. And the third case is really interesting. Here we deal with Messenia, daughter of Publius, who founded Portico, probably in the temple for Magna Mater, using her and only her money, and she emphasized it. So she wrote an inscription that she used her own money to build a portico. So big thing. But what is, in my opinion, the most interesting, but unfortunately very rare, is a personal experience of a dedicant. Among all of inscriptions set up by women in Dalmatia, there is only one with this case. A freed woman whose name was Julia Maxima and who lived in ancient Salona in 1st or 2nd century AD, founded the inscription to Liber Pater as the result of something having been seen. It is ex viso in Latin. It could be evidence that she had some specific individual religious experience connected directly with contact with God, for example, in a dream, or she saw a sculpture, for example, of this God somewhere, so she saw the God. Among the gods who were mentioned in the inscriptions were, for example, Roma Augusta, Isis, Asclepius Magna Mater, Liber Pater, and Silvanus. So not only deities who were worshipped only by women and occupied of women's birth, childhood, etc. What is a bit interesting, it's Silvanus, this god here, is subject to special attention from the archaeologists from former Yugoslavia, who consider him to be a dual deity. Distinguishing a Roman god, when mentioned in inscriptions, from a local deity on representations such as the one on the slide. a clear underestimation of the complexities of religious and ethnic identities in antiquity. Here are some other examples, only to see their quality, which isn't good, also the quality of letters. And these inscriptions aren't big. I mean, the biggest one which I found has about 61 centimeters, so it isn't so high. And mostly they were made in limestone, so not also the cheapest material, but the local one. As we could observe, women in Roman Dalmatia weren't silent in religious aspects of their lives. They could have had money to express their religiosity in public places and thereby confirm their adherence to the Roman culture and to the Roman world. Even though they were deprived of many laws, they wanted to be heard, which made them strong in their position in Roman Dalmatian society, maybe even stronger or better than the men's one. Thank you.